Hello, in this video I'm going to walk you through the Chapter 2 article deconstruction, just to give you a little help with your homework this weekend. So this is the assignment. You'll find it in the bottom of Module 2. I have a couple of peer-reviewed articles. There's this link. This one is going to help with the citation, and here talks about how to do APA formatting for references in Word. And then here are the assignment instructions with the questions that you'll answer. And so the idea of this is that it's going to help you with writing your literature review. This one is a general one with an article that the class will share. And then you will do 6 of these before the end of the semester with articles that you find. And it's just to help you. You're deconstructing the article. You're breaking it down to help you understand it better. And I just want to emphasize that you have to read the article first. Don't attempt the article deconstruction on your first read. Read the article all the way through, take notes, highlight things, whatever works for you, and then come back and do the deconstruction. So at this point, when you're watching this video, you should have read the article at least once. And so this is the annotated PDF. So this one up here is going to help you with the references. This one up here is color-coded to match the assignment. So I'm going to go ahead and just open this one up instead. So here is the article called The Effects of Password Type and Memory Techniques on User Password Memory. So you should be familiar with the parts of a peer-reviewed article from last week. We have our abstract, we have our introduction. See here, I've highlighted some things for you in different colors. Here we have our methods section. We have our results section, and we have our discussion section. And so you'll see that while writing a paper isn't a cookie cutter design, a lot of times you'll find similar information, the information you need in specific spots. So let's go ahead and start with the first question. The first question is asking you to cite an APA format. So this is showing you how you're going to use the author's last name, and then their initials, the second author's last name, and then initials, and so on and so forth. Then you put the year that it was published in parentheses, the title of article, and this is in sentence case. Notice that only the first word of the article is capitalized. Then you put the title of the periodical or the journal, and notice that this is in title case, where both all the major words are going to be capitalized, and it's italicized. Then the volume, you just put the number, you don't put volume, is also italicized. If there's an issue number, that goes in parentheses, then the pages, followed by the DOI URL. Most articles these days have a DOI. The library provides a permalink DOI that you can use. And sometimes maybe there isn't a DOI, especially for older articles, so you do need to provide some sort of URL for your reference section. So we'll go ahead and work through this citation in a different video, because that takes a little bit more time. We're going to go ahead and start with number 2. What is the purpose or the objective of the study? So you want to find the statement where the authors tell what they are testing. What's the purpose? What's the meaning of this article? Why are they doing this research? So most of the time you'll find it at the very end of the introduction. That's where you'll put it in your final research paper, is the last 2 paragraphs of that introduction. You might find it in the abstract, but a really good place to start looking is the last 2 paragraphs of the introduction. So we're going to go ahead, we're going to go up here. This is our abstract, and again, it might be in here, but if we go down to the end of here of the introduction, we can see here it was predicted that participants using the chunking method would report better memory for both standard and passphrase passwords as measured by blah, 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 because password phrases are regarded as easy to remember. So here they're giving you their hypothesis. And you can include that. The hypothesis could be kind of the part of the purpose, but really up here, if you look here, it says the present study's purpose of examining how chunking affects recall for standard passwords and passphrases. So I'm gonna highlight that. I got a little bit extra, but that's okay. And I'm gonna go back over to the thing, and it says, see here, part A is asking for a quote. So I want you to provide me that quote. And I'm going to go ahead and just copy and paste. Here it's decided that it wants to the bulleting, so I'm going to go here to home and I'm going to remove that bulleting. And then I'm going to add quotation marks. And it ended up kind of pasting it weird, so I'm going to go ahead and just kind of make sure that it's looks a little bit better, deleting some things and adding a final quote. Oh, I didn't need this sentence, so we'll delete this. And it doesn't have to be perfect, okay? I'm just looking, this quote is there really for me, okay? You should know the purpose. You've read the article all the way through, and so with your articles, this is telling me what the authors of the paper are saying the purpose is, and then down below, you are gonna put this in your own words. So here, describe the purpose of the study in your own words, paraphrase the quote from 2A. So when I say paraphrase, what you really should do is, it should look like this. You shouldn't be able to see what you've put in quotes. You should just be able to put it in your own words. And I'm not gonna do that here for you. But the idea is, what is the purpose of the study? And you've read the whole thing, so you should know it, not having to look at the quote, not changing words around in that quote. Cover the quote up and put it in your own words. And we move on to number 3. What are the major findings of the study? Now, the major findings you're gonna find in the results. There might be some of that in the abstract too, but probably not enough for you to fully understand the results of the study. They also are restated in the discussion, but we're gonna go to the results. That's where you wanna go. If you look at A, it says, quote the specific findings from the results. This should include statistics that are reported. And again, you're not gonna put statistics in your summary, but I want you to start getting familiar with how statistics are reported, kind of reminding you of some of the stuff you learned in statistics. So we're gonna go ahead and go back to that peer-reviewed article. And I'm gonna go to the results section. So remember, this was the introduction. The results is gonna come after the methods section. And here's the results section. So this, if you notice, is not the same color as this. This is green, right? So I wanna find the green part. Of course, in your own articles, you're just gonna have to find it on your own. But here, so this pink part, we'll get to this later. This is really talking about the design of the study and really gives you information about the variables. So I wanna go ahead and highlight all this that is in green. Copy, Control C. So we just wanna remember that it says it was statistically significant. I go back to the Word document. And then I'm just going to, this was a D, but somehow it came up weird. I'm just gonna try to, again, make it look a little nicer. And I'm just gonna speed through that just to, for the sake of time. Then the next part, B, is another quote. Quote, the conclusions that the authors made based off those results. Most likely you'll find that in the first part of the discussion. So again, I would say 9 out of 10 papers, when you get after the results section, when you get to the discussion, that first couple paragraphs, they're gonna restate the findings without those statistics and kind of put it in more of a conclusion, overall findings type of thing. Especially, a lot of the studies you read are gonna have multiple experiments and you are responsible for summarizing all of those experiments if the paper you've chosen has more than one. But sometimes at the discussion, they'll have kind of an overall summary of what those findings all mean. So here I want to get this kind of like an orangey red. So I'm going to go back to my article. I'm going to go down to this discussion and look, it is right here in that first paragraph. So I'm going to go ahead and copy that. Control C, V, we don't need this part. I'm going to put an end quote. And I'm not requiring you to cite these quotations either, because you're not going to use quotations in your paper. Technically, yes, if you're providing a quotation, you should have a citation. But you're going to tell me at the top of the paper where all this is coming from, what the article is. And then I want you to practice citing the summaries, the paraphrase portion. The most important one to summarize is going to be this quote. You want to practice citing the reference, and it's an in-text citation. And I'll get to that. I'll talk about that more on the reference part, the reference video. Okay, so now it wants you to summarize the results and conclusion in your own words. You don't want to report statistics or present F values, you just, and you don't want to go line by line. So you want to practice, you can practice citing the reference again. However, in your summaries, you only cite in APA formatting, you only cite once at the top of the paragraph when you first start summarizing your article, and then you don't need to cite again unless you change topics or something else or come back to the article later on, maybe in the discussion. So the results of this study suggested that the effectiveness of chunking on the ability to remember passwords depends on the type of password being used. Specifically, participants who were asked to remember a standard password did better when using chunking, but participants who were asked to remember a multi-passphrase did better without chunking. So what does that mean? Okay, again, cover it up. Don't look at it when you're paraphrasing. You don't want to go line by line. You don't change words around. That is considered plagiarism, and that can earn you a zero on an assignment. You want to put it into your own words. What does it mean? So chunking was beneficial or was helpful for standard passcodes, but for passphrases, it was not. Again, you've read the article already. Now you're coming back and deconstructing the article, and so you should have an understanding of what they found, what those results mean. And if you don't, you need to reread the article. And if it's really too complicated, sometimes certain articles might be too complicated. You're just starting out learning to read peer review articles. Move on to another one. You know, if you're doing music and memory or mnemonic devices or whatever it is you're doing, and it's an article that is an imaging article talking about brain function and things like that, and you don't really understand how the brain works very well, even if you've taken a basic psychobiology class, it might be too complicated for you to summarize. And you don't really need those articles because we're not going to be using brain imaging in our studies, so they're not as relevant to your own research. All right, so you're going to practice summarizing there in your own words. You're making it shorter than what the original was, and you're giving the overall meaning here. So the idea is that you can take these summaries and you can kind of put them all together for your own summaries in your literature review. So you can take the purpose, and then in your own deconstructions, I have the order just changed a little bit. This is really the order that you should read articles in. In your own deconstructions, I have the questions in the way that you would put them together. So you'd have your purpose summary, you'd have your methodology summary with your participant information and kind of a brief summary of what they did. Then you'd provide the results and use this results summary, and then connect it to the article. So now we're going to go on. This is what would come second. This is the participants or who are the participants or the subjects in the experiment. So we're going to look and find who are the participants. It's probably going to be in the method section. Again, you might find that information in the abstract, but the method section is going to really give you a lot more detail. So we go back to our article, and the method section was up above the results. So here, you notice there it was a part A and a part B. I actually have them color-coded for you. So the participants, we're going to take this one first. Participants included 57 women, 39 women and 16 men, 2 unreported. Put my quote, control V, end quote. Then I'm going to go back. So now I want to know how they selected the participants. And sometimes students will say, oh, they don't tell me how they select them. They always give you some sort of information. I mean, unless your article is really old, it may not be specifically that they say participants were recruited this way, but they might say that they came from, even just, you know, how they recruited them, that they came from a liberal arts college. If this part up here wasn't there, you might want to just include that as how they were selected. So now I want to summarize in my own words the combination of these two. And notice that I say you want to practice citing the references. I think in your article deconstructions for the literature review, I give some more instructions that say specifically in the literature review you need to have the number of participants and one other demographic like age, gender, socioeconomic status, something that's relevant. But I mean, most articles are going to include age and gender. And some will include other things that are important. So you need to include that. And so that's the summary here. The next question is, what are the variables in the experiment? So this one may not actually go in your summary, but it's something that's included here as well as in your own article deconstructions, because I think it really helps you to understand the research. It also lets me see that you're catching on to some of the things we're learning in the class or that you're not catching on. This study is a true experiment, so we'll have an independent and dependent variable. Some of the studies that you'll look at, maybe a lot of the studies you look at, depending on your topic, may be more descriptive, correlational in nature, quasi-experimental, all those different things. And while quasi-experimental would have an independent and dependent variable, correlational studies, descriptive studies may not have those. And so you might just have a whole bunch of variables that are measured, and that's what would go here. But if we go back to our PDF, again, it says, you know, you might find the variables in the materials and methods section, perhaps the abstracts or the results, but either the top of the results or in the methods section is really where is the best place to look for this, what the variables are. And here it is listed here. I have it color coded in pink for you. So participants were randomly assigned to one of four conditions based on the two factors of password type and chunking: the standard password with chunking group, the standard password with no chunking, and so on and so forth. So I'm gonna go to Control C. Now I think there was actually a little bit more. It wasn't just this one section. I think I had a little bit more highlighted here. So if we go here, participants were asked to recall their passwords. That's telling me what the dependent variable is. And memory for the passwords was based on how many attempts it took the participants to remember. So just for ease, I'm gonna go ahead and highlight all of this. So this tells me that there were four conditions. There were two factors. One is password type and one is chunking. So like we will learn this as we go on, but the idea is that there's two separate independent variables here. This is gonna be a factorial design, something we'll talk about at the end of the semester. So we have a standard password and a multi-word password. So password is one independent variable with two levels, standard and multi-word passphrase. Then we have chunking. We have a group that was provided a method of chunking and a group that wasn't. So again, that's a second independent variable. And then our dependent variable is memory as measured by the number of attempts it took them to remember the passwords. So here you're going to summarize that in your own words. So just, and this is where you're just going to tell me the independent variable of the article, or the independent variable was this, and you have two. The dependent variable was this. Again, this probably won't go in your summaries for your article deconstructions. It really, though, does, it really helps you understand the study better. And then here we have number six. How did the researchers test their hypothesis? So we're looking for orange in the article. How they tested their hypothesis will be again in the results, or sorry, the methods section. So as it says here, in the methods section. And I had multiple things, so it's this part. It was the skinny lines, the experiment. So it consists of three rounds of a word scramble game. And copy that here. And there was more though. So this is telling me that there were three rounds. Participants had to log in. The screen randomly assigned them to what type of password they got. There's a little bit more here, but then participants in the no chunking condition saw one box, so it's telling you what the chunking condition did, or people in the chunking condition did, and how that differed from the no chunking condition. That's an important part of the methodology. And then at the end of it, after successfully entering the passphrase, they played the game. Passwords were shown on the game for each round, and prompts were described as above. So again, you've already read this. You should understand all this of what's going on. This is just really, again, for me, so I don't have to go back and pull up. So again, you've read everything through, but now maybe go through and check the quote, maybe take a few little notes if you hadn't already, and then here you're gonna summarize the steps. What did those participants do? In some cases, you might be describing different scales or measurements that were used. If they use different scales and measurements, list those, okay? That not only is that important in helping the reader understand what they did, but that's gonna be helpful information for you. So you're using these articles as a stepping stone to help you design your own experiments. So you want to understand what scales and measurements were used to manipulate these variables, to measure these variables. So this one is going to say you're going to pick a table or figure, and then you're going to just describe what it's showing. And here, this is limitations to the methods. This is, again, one that probably won't go into your summaries. It doesn't need to go into your summaries in your literature review. But again, it's a good place, as you saw from a previous assignment, a good place to find ideas for your own research is the limitations and future directions. So we're going to go there. We're going to go to the discussion. And here it's yellow, but circled in green. So future research could work to explore the interaction further and better understand the nature of the passwords. And sometimes students get to this one and they're like, oh, I don't want to do anymore. And so they'll just say, oh, there were no future directions or limitations. Most articles are going to have future directions or limitations. I very rarely, maybe a really old article, which is probably one that you shouldn't be using, might not, but because when they comes back from the reviewers want them to, you know, mention what their limitations are. So there I've, you know, got some future directions and some limitations. And then you want to briefly describe, so this part B is not summarizing, it's telling me what could you do? What kind of study could you do? So that's why you don't need to include this in your own article or your own literature review summaries, is because this is really to help you think about studies you could do. So what's feasible? You know, try to use these future directions and limitations to help you kind of think about research designs for your own study. And so that's it. Again, because this is a little long, I will go ahead and post the reference citation in a different video. Hopefully that's helpful. Again, remember, when you're paraphrasing, you want to put things into your own words. Changing words around, using a thesaurus to change things does not work. You need to understand this material. So maybe not this article, but you need to understand the articles that you're reading, because otherwise you're going to have a really difficult time designing your experiment. All right, thank you for listening.